Good morning, everybody. I want to share something to you special for me. You know, I've got my notes on Sundays. If kind of goes, the pastor's not going to open up, I got to talk, which I don't want to sometimes. But I was, the Lord reminded me of something. My grandmother, she lived to be 96 years old, and she had 7 daughters, no boys. And she lived past my mother, who was the oldest of all the 7 daughters, but we would always get together for family greetings. And she would always do this. She looked frail, but she was strong. She would say, "Everybody." And you know, sometimes you can't appreciate things until you get older, but that was a call to arms. In the Christian community, we call that a call to worship. And she would say, "Everybody," with the arthritic self. She would. And we knew, because their primary goal, all my aunts, my mom especially, was to make sure that we gathered and prayed. Isn't that a beautiful thing? I mean, we'd be out drinking in the parking lot, me and my buddies, and, "Oh, grandma's calling, everybody." And that's what I feel for you guys this morning. I feel like God is saying, "Everybody, everybody." Can you hear that? That's the voice of the Lord. That was just something special that happened to me in prayer. I hope that blesses you. I'm thinking about my grandmother. 88 years old, she played basketball with us. Isn't that cool? She loved the Lord. She loved the Lord. You know, together as we minister today, I want to just remind you guys, as we call out to the Lord today, he says if we seek him, we seek him with all of our hearts, that we'd find him. It says, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all," can you guys say all? "All these things will be added unto you." All of them. What are those things? Joy, maybe? Then am I need more joy? Peace? Hope? The salvation of a lost loved one? Everything that we need is in God. You know what he does when he calls us? Everybody. What he's saying is that I want a relationship with you. That's what he said. He says, "I want to spend time, all of us little cousin, little rugrats running around." That's what he's doing. Come on, everybody. He wants a relationship. When he's saying worship me, he's saying, don't be pious. Don't come into all the art God. He's saying, be real with me. Come on, this is Daddy. Oh, I feel the goodness of God. I feel the goodness of God's love for me as one of his babies. I feel good. Hallelujah. Amen, honey. Remember grandma? Everybody. Hallelujah. God's main goal is a relationship with this family. I'm going to tell you something. King David said this. He said, "There's nothing compared to knowing God closely." In Psalm 73, 25, 26, he writes, "Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God," come on, "but God is the strength of my life and my portion forever." I would say that's all and amen. All and everything, all and amen. Father God, we bless you. We thank you for pulling us together. I thank you that whatever people are going through today, whether a great time or a bad time, difficult times or hard times, that all that we need is in you. We raise a hallelujah, Father God, in the middle of everything. We magnify your name in the middle of everything. We glorify you. And Father, I pray your presence goes out unto your people today as we surrender this time of worship and praise, as we minister to you and you alone. I call it established for you, church. Can you receive it? Come on, church. Everybody to the feet, praising God. Hey, Dan and Sharon. Love you guys. So good to see you. Hands together. I'll raise a hallelujah. Can you raise your hands? Yes. Love my enemies. He's so good. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. Something is a melody. Ooh, you sound so good, church.
Always a hallelujah.
Heaven is fighting for us.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
With all of your heart. Come on.
And I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm.
Louder,
louder and louder. We're gonna hear our raises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. He's alive, church. Woo! Hallelujah. Let's do that again. I raise a hallelujah. Come on, church.
I'll raise a hallelujah.
With everything inside of me.
I'll raise a hallelujah.
I will watch the darkness flee.
I will watch the darkness flee. I'll raise a hallelujah.
In the middle of the mystery.
In the middle of the mystery. I raise up.
I bind fear in Jesus' name. I cast fear out in the name of Jesus. Fear, you will not have a hold of God's people.
And I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar. And up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
Come on. Woo! Yeah. Call out, church. You ready for the bridge?
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
That is.
Sing a little louder.
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 Build it up a little bit.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence. There it is.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Last time. Come on, church.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of. There it is.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief. You guys sound so good.
Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder. I'm gonna sing.
Woo!
In the middle of a storm.
Come on.
Louder and louder. You're gonna hear that praises roar. And up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing,
there it is.
In the middle of the storm.
Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. Hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll raise a hallelujah.
One more time.
I'll raise a hallelujah.
In the presence of our enemies, Lord, we praise you. We raise your name, Lord. We praise you, Jesus.
I'll raise a hallelujah.
I'll raise a hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All right, church. I know this is going to be a little bit different than what we're accustomed to doing. You know, so this song, right, Raise a Hallelujah, and what was the lyrics there as we sang it? I just felt an unction of God when it talks about raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. So this morning as we're praying through Ephesians 3, church is the demonstration or the evidence of God's manifold wisdom to all the principalities and powers. It's a reminder to them that the church of Jesus Christ is how God is going to move in the earth. It's going to be through the church, the Holy Spirit working in God's people, the power of the living God working in God's people, and that this is how God is going to demonstrate the kingdom of God advancing in the earth. And so what I want to do in this moment is I want to ask you as the church to come in agreement. Matthew 18 says, if two of you would agree concerning anything that they ask, it shall be done for them by my Father in heaven. Amen? This is what Matthew 18 says. This is the Bible. This is what Jesus says. And then after that, he says, if two or three of you are gathered together, he says, there I am in your midst. So the Bible tells us two things. And Jesus is talking about this in the instance of brothers, an offended brother, working things out, being unified, being one heart. Okay, so God wants where he says you've won your brother, you're together, you're unified. And so then he begins to tell us, now there's great power when you pray the prayer of agreement. And he says, if two, he doesn't say two or three right there. He says, if two of you will agree concerning anything that they ask, it shall be done for them by my Father in heaven. And where two or three of you are gathered together, there I am in your midst. Amen. Does the Word of God say that? That's what Jesus says. I want to pray for Dan Kenny, our brother Dan Kenny. I want to ask Dan and Sharon Kenny, could you please come forward? I want to pray over you. In church, I want you to be mindful. There are spirits of unbelief that want to hinder the work of God. There's spirits of unbelief that want to hinder what God is about to do in Dan's life, what God is doing. Yeah, both of you come on up here and let everybody, as the church, got the elders. Say again. And church, would you, whoever wants to come forward and just pray and agree, and if you want to put your hands on them, stretch your hands towards them, because we're going to do this as a family. The Word of God says if anyone's sick, they're to ask for the elders to come and pray. Dan has asked for prayer this morning. The Bible says in James, the prayer of faith will heal the sick. The Word of God also tells us, again, to pray, agree concerning anything that they ask. It shall be done for them by my Father in heaven. We're asking for Dan's complete healing. Amen, Sharon? We're asking for God's complete healing in Dan. And so, but we also are aware, church, we're aware that there are spirits of unbelief that try to, as we pray, that spirit of unbelief is going to try and settle and say, oh no, it's not going to happen for him. So we don't listen to that. We don't listen to that. We don't listen to that. That's not that we don't listen to that voice, because that's a lie. You understand, the devil is a liar. Everything that comes out of the devil is a lie. We do understand that sickness occurs, but that's not the plan of God. We understand that Jesus, when he died on the cross, Isaiah tells us, Isaiah 53 says, by his stripes we are healed. This is the Word of God. So we need to speak the Word of God over every instance, over every situation. We need to speak the Word of God, not man's thoughts, not the thoughts of the enemy, not the fear, not giving into fear. The power of God is going to touch Dan's body, and he's going to be completely healed.
Yes,
but we have to agree,
yes.
Church, according to the Word of God, according to what the Word of God says, we speak the Word of God over Dan, and the power of the Holy Spirit confirms the Word of God. Amen? Yes. The Holy Spirit confirms the words of Jesus. He reminds us of the words of Jesus, And so we're speaking according to what the Word of God says. So, Brother Dan. Amen. So, Lord, we thank you for your word, the power of the Holy Spirit alive, alive in Dan right now. Heaven comes down right now over Dan by the power of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit in us. As Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, this cancer is gone now, obliterated in the name of Jesus. The power of the living God from the throne room of heaven into Dan's body now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we agree according to your word. We agree according to your word, Lord God, the power of heaven, the life of God. The same Holy Spirit who raised Christ Jesus from the dead brings life to Dan's mortal body, to Dan's mortal body in the name of Jesus. You have the oil there, Elder Ed? Would you lay hands on Brother Dan now? In the name of Jesus. Lord God, your word says that the elders will anoint now the prayer of faith. We're praying in faith. And Lord God, your word says that by the prayer of faith, Lord, we agree according to your word, and the sick will recover.
Yes,
the sick will recover, and Lord God, all of Dan's sins have been forgiven. And so, Lord God, he stands before you pure, healed, and whole, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, by the power of the living God. The anointing is on you, Dan. The anointing of God, the power of God, and the agreement of the saints is here. This is the power of the living God. This is what the kingdom of God is. It's not just one man. It's the people of God. It's the church in proper order with the leadership and with the church family together, the family of God, as God ordains. So, Lord, we thank you now. Healing, healing, in the name of Jesus.
Father God, I just lift my brother Dan up to you, Lord God, and I thank you that you love him more than we could even imagine, Father God, that you are with him right now in spirit, and you are just lifting him up and giving him peace, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, that he's committing this to you, Father God, and he's trusting in you, Lord God, and believing in you for this healing, Lord God. And we also in agreement believe for this healing, Lord God. This cancer cannot stay. It must be removed. It has to flee in Jesus' name, Lord God. It has to leave, Father God. We believe this because your word says it. Your word is truth. We trust in you, Lord God. And we just bless you. We give you all the honor and glory, all the praise in Jesus' name.
You know, this morning I was reading in John chapter 5.
Hallelujah.
And in John chapter 5, it's the story of the paralytic man at the pool of Bethesda. And he's sitting there waiting because he can't walk. This man is paralyzed. And the pool was known to they said that that an angel would come and stir the waters, and that whoever could get in there first would be healed. Now, there could have been some kind of mineral water thing going on, and you get in and the aches and pains go away, but Jesus came to this paralytic man. And that paralytic man had been there for 30 plus years waiting. And in all that time, he could not go to the temple because he was paralyzed. He wasn't allowed in the temple. And Jesus said, do you want to be healed? And he said, yes, but I can't get there fast enough. Everyone beats me. I'm paralyzed. I can't really move. But Jesus said, let me touch you. And all it took was one touch from the Lord to heal him.
Come on.
He got up. And do you know what the first thing he did was? He went to the temple. He went to the temple to worship God because God had touched him and healed him. It wasn't the water. It's not the doctors. But it's the touch from the Lord. And when I read that this morning, my heart, I thought, gosh, he just wanted to worship God in the temple. And it wasn't until Jesus touched him that he was allowed to come back in. And that's where Jesus found him later in the temple worshiping God.
That's beautiful.
So the takeaway is this. We believe Jesus to heal, to touch. All it takes is one touch from the Lord and to worship him in the midst of it.
Yes.
And I know you're a worshiper, Dan. And I know you're a worshiper, Sharon. So continue to worship him in the midst of this.
Yes.
So we just thank you for that word this morning, Lord God. That one healing touch from you, Jesus, that's all it takes. And keep our hearts right that we would continue to worship you no matter what. What else can we do but worship the one true God? What else can we do but lift up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Trusting and believing in you, Lord God. We thank you for healing in Dan's body right now in the name of Jesus. We speak over any spirit of unbelief that it must flee. But what if this? But what if? Oh, no, no. Don't let those thoughts come in. You just keep speaking faith. You keep speaking truth. You keep speaking the word. By his stripes you are healed.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, Dan, I just asked something real quick. I was thinking, how do I pray for my friend, God? And I feel like the Lord says, we need to get an image of heaven. You know, Pastor said a couple of weeks ago, thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And it's real easy to talk unless you're going through it, right, Sharon? It's real easy for all that. But, you know, I saw it as I was sitting there. I was like, Lord, how do I pray for my friend? And he said, once you start getting an image of what heaven is like, not because you're going anytime. Don't let the enemy play tricks. Because the fear and the reality of circumstances, the appointments, the questions, that's going to want to bombard your mind. And what God is going to do is he's going to start giving you an image of what it's like in heaven. But don't let the enemy use that to try to give you some other images. No, on earth as it is in heaven for Dan Kenny. Because there's nothing missing and there's nothing broken. Right? We raise a hallelujah in the middle of the report. Because the report's not the truth. Jesus is the truth. The report's not the answer. Jesus is the answer. So when the storms come to the mind, I know you're a strong man. We talk. And I know that you're a man of faith. You're encouraging me more times than I can imagine. But I want you to get an image of heaven. An image and saying, on earth as it is here. I don't need to worry about heaven. I need to do my work here. And I want to focus on that. You're going to find joy in you too, Sharon. Because the enemy's going to come and he's going to lie and he's going to tell you things that are so factual and statistics that will make you want to just chew nicotine gum. Come on, somebody. But I want you to close your eyes because I was seeing the image of heaven. I want to go on pastor. She was talking about this yesterday about the Garden of Eden and eternity. And my brain has just been on fire with synapses. And I pray that for you, that you would get that image, that you would close your eyes. And in the middle of the storm, where the enemy, you know how he is, oh, yeah, yeah. And Sharon, you know, he comes in, oh, you guys, and I tell you what, you've been faithful givers. And look at this. And you say, in the middle of the mystery, see Jesus walking, see Jesus going, Dan, it was for you. Dan, it wasn't for just, it was for you right now. Dan, it was for you. Sharon, it's for you. The hope and the healing for you, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven for you, for such a time as this. Father, we thank you as everybody is praying. We stand in agreement with the elders, with the pastors. We stand in agreement with your loving people over this couple, over their children, over Jamie and Augie, and those precious grandchildren, that they would see images of you. And Lord, I declare a thing in Jesus' name, that the ministry that comes out of this is going to just transform this family in ways that are unimaginable, and that other people, Father God, are going to be set free because of what you're going to do. Last word, we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Thank you. Let that be real in both of their lives. In Jesus' name, hallelujah.
Amen. All right, so here's what I heard the Lord when we're praying over you both. There's two things. So first, when we first started praying for you, what I saw was, I saw water, or what looked like water, coming from heaven. It was full of light, and it was falling on you both. Now we know that the Spirit of God is described as living water. So I believe that to be the Holy Spirit just washing over you both. Cleansing was your healing. But also for you, Sharon, it was the Holy Spirit bringing security to you, that the Lord is saying that, my daughter, trust me in this and know that my hand is upon you both. I'm not going to leave you abandoned. I'm not going to leave you alone. But the Lord says, trust me in this. I'm drawing you closer to me. I'm bringing this to bring you closer to me in this circumstance. But the Lord says, my daughter, you're not alone, and I'm not going to leave you a widow. So this washing of heaven coming upon you is because the Father loves you. And he says, my daughter, you're mine. I have planned and purposed for you. I'm not going to bring darkness and evil to you, but I'm going to bring comfort and strength to you. But I saw the healing of the living God upon you, Brother Dan. The doctors are going to be very surprised. You're going to get a good report, but they're not going to understand what's going on. They're going to tell you something different, and that's okay. But you're going to know this is the Lord, because he loves you, Dan, because he loves you, Sharon. And I believe that this is what the heart of the Father is saying to you both, is that learn my love for you. Learn my love for you. You know God. You know the Lord. But I hear the Lord saying, the heart of the Father, I'm teaching you to learn my love for you in a greater way. Because what's going to happen is that love, God's going to teach you that you're going to love others in a greater way than you've ever known before. You're going to see the love of God. It's going to manifest in healing, but it's also going to manifest in something so much bigger than what you thought this was going to be. The enemy had plans for destruction, but God is using this for good. Can you believe this? Can you both receive this and believe this? All right. I believe this is what God is doing. I believe this is what we're hearing here. So we agree. Amen, church? We agree. Lord, you said when two agree concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Father, this is what we believe. This is, Lord, your word says that this is the confidence that we have, according to 1 John 5:14-15, that whatever we ask according to your will, we know that healing is your will. By your stripes are we healed, Lord God. This is your will. So whatever we pray according to your will, we know that you hear us. And if we know that you hear us, whatever we ask, for this situation, this is for Dan's healing, this is for strength to Sharon, this is for the love of God to grow, the fullness of God is the love of God. It will be done for them. It will be done. We have the petitions that we're asking for, Lord God. We have your answer. Lord God, this is your word. This is your word. Faith comes from hearing the word of God. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So we speak the word of faith. We speak your word, and we believe according to your word, Lord God. Your power, the life of God, through the Holy Spirit
the life of God, heaven, heaven coming to earth. This is what we're praying. This is what you told us to pray. Heaven, heaven coming now. Heaven in this moment. Heaven bringing healing. Heaven bringing strength. Heaven confirming your love upon my brother and my sister. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise God. We love you. We love you, Dan and Sharon. We love you. God bless you. Praise God. Praise God. Can y'all say we love Dan and Sharon Kenny?
Love Dan and Sharon Kenny. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Can we get our last worship song here for this morning?
Yes. Oh, man. God is so good. Man, as we do this next song, how great is our God? We're doing this in faith. Let's keep that same sentiment in terms of our temple. Hallelujah. Oh, that was so good. Whew. Jesus. The splendor of, we're talking about Jesus, folks. Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. There it is. In darkness, still high, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Come on, church, by faith, I want you all to say, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will sing, how great, how great. For right now, church, and time is in his hand, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, and Son is Jesus, the Lion. Lion and the Lamb. Oh, he's so good. And how great is our God. Would you sing with me? How great is our God. And all will sing how great is our God. Let's do that again, chorus. How great. Our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will sing, how great is our God. You're the name, Jesus, you're the name above all names. All worthy of all praise, and our heart will sing, how great is our God. Oh, sing it again, you're the name above all names. good, church. How great. Hallelujah.
How great is our
It's all about him, church.
Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Oh, play it again, play it again. Oh, we worship you, Jesus.
How great.
Oh, the choir of God sing it. Oh, he's so good. He's so holy. He's so righteous. He's the healer. He's your deliverer. He's our God. Oh, holy Jesus.
How great. Keep going. Is our God.
Come on, with all your heart.
Jesus. And how great is our God.
Yes.
Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Let me hear your voices. Jesus, let's sing it. Come on, come on.
How great.
There's a choir of God right there. Yes, he's so happy.
Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will sing how great is our God.
And I see God calling the holy angels, everybody, everybody, look at my kids. Hallelujah.
Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord God. Yes. Great are you, living God. Great are you, living God. Great are you, living God. You know, I was talking about this, I think it was last week, but sometimes we have to remember the Lord wants to just draw us into that living room place. You know what he's talking about in Revelation 3? He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. To him who opens, I will come and dine with him. I'll come and have a relationship with him. And sometimes we have to see that in this place of worship. So that sometimes we just got to come into that living room atmosphere with the Lord. You know, when you come into the living room, it's relaxed. There's peace. But there's the love of God. There's enjoyment. Where we're worshiping the Lord. And he's receiving our praise and worship, and he's enjoying it, but it's also us taking joy in loving God. It's also that place where we need to learn to grow, to just enjoy loving God. Just enjoy just worshiping the Lord. Just enjoy that you get to come and be in God's presence. This is what Israel understood when they said, I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. When King David wrote that, the Bible calls it, it's a song of ascents. Meaning they were going up. They were going up to Zion. Because Israel, because Jerusalem was on the hill. So in order to go to Jerusalem, in order to go to where God's presence was, they had to go up. They had to ascend. And that's why it's called a psalm of ascents. They're going up. But when they were going up, they were saying, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said to me, we get to go into God's house and be with the Lord, and we get to be with God together. Since we're talking about that, you just come into the house of God as the church. See, he's knocked on the door, and we've opened it. We said, come on in, Lord. That's why he says when two or three are gathered together, he says, there I am. I'm right there. I'm in your midst. I'm in the living room with you. I'm receiving your worship. My presence is with you. The angels of God are with us. God's presence, the Holy of Holies, is here. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Say me, church, me. He loves you. He loves me. He loves you. He loves you. You know, we get these wrong ideas because we don't meet these conditions that we've set up in our head that are not the truth of God, and we think, well, I don't meet that requirement, so God doesn't love me as much as he loves other people in the church. No, that's not the word of God.
God so loves you. So loves you. So receive his love. Receive all that Jesus has for you. Open your hearts to him to be able to come into the living room, to be able to come in this place where he can dine with us. He brings the food that we need. He's the one that fills the hungry soul. He's the one that satisfies the longing soul, and he fills the hungry soul with his goodness, is what Psalm 107:9 says. So he fills us, church. It's not about you bringing the food. He brings it. He brings the spiritual food that we need. We come with a longing soul. We come with a hungry heart. And he fills it. He satisfies the longing soul, and he fills the hungry heart with his goodness. And that's what he's doing right now, church. That's what the Lord does. He comes with his goodness. We sing how great he is. And what does God do in response to receiving the praise and worship? He comes and he fills your heart with his goodness. And he reminds you how good he is, that he loves you, and he's purposed you, and he has a future for you. He has a plan for you. He has a purpose for you. It's not just that we come and worship him. It's that he reminds you, and he teaches you, and he shows you. He says, no, I have a good purpose for you. The thoughts that I have for you are good and not evil, to give you hope, to give you a future. We have a future in the living God, and we have hope in the living God. It's not about the circumstance. It's not about what we see around us. It's in the living God. It's in the living God. It's we look to him. He is yes and amen. His promises are yes and amen. We look to the living God. So let's worship him, church. Let's worship him. Let's love him. Let's receive his love. Let's receive his goodness. Lord, we receive your goodness now. We come, we approach you with grateful hearts. But Lord, thank you that you fill the longing soul. You satisfy the longing soul, and you fill the hungering heart with your goodness. Lord, we receive your goodness now. Every situation that we're dealing with, every obstacle, everything that's been hindering, Lord God, right now we look at it through the eyes of your goodness. It's your goodness working in us right now. You're satisfying the longing of our soul, that waiting for you to answer. You're satisfying by your spirit, by your presence, and you're filling our heart with your goodness. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for your presence. Satisfying the longing soul and filling the hungry heart with your goodness. With your goodness. You know, the Word of God tells us this. 1 Corinthians 11. Going to receive communion, but let us examine our hearts right now. Let us examine our hearts. You know, it was a pre-service prayer. Sister Pam was sharing about Yom Kippur and the Day of Atonement, how she communicated the truth. Christ, he's our atonement. He's our high priest. On the Day of Atonement was only one day out of the year when the high priest, he would go into the Holy of Holies for all of Israel, for all the nation, for atonement. We know in Christ, he's done that now for all of us. It's done once and for all. And we have our forgiveness. We have our atonement. We stand before the Lord as righteous. But the Bible says this. We're to examine our hearts. 1 Corinthians 11, 26 through 32. It says, every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, the Bible says you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes. What does that mean? What does that mean that you're announcing his death
until he returns. It means what you're doing is you, by faith, as you're receiving the bread and receiving the cup, you're representing and you're signifying, first and foremost, that the Lord has died for me. He's died for you. What you're saying is you're saying, Lord, you have died for me. You've died for me. When you take this bread and you take this cup, what you're saying before heaven and all creation is you acknowledge that Jesus died for you. You're not saying that, oh, he died for others. You're receiving it by faith. You're saying, Lord, thank you that you died for me. You paid the price for my sin. You did it. And you're also saying, Lord, I believe you're coming back. It's a witness. It's a witness before God and creation that you believe, that you know the Lord is coming back. He's coming back to the earth. He's coming back for his people. He's coming back to accomplish all that the Lord has purposed, as the Word of God says. And so it says, so if anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. In other words, don't let the familiarity of this cause you to receive this in a wrong way or in an unworthy manner, or to not acknowledge the significance of the power of the Spirit of God at work in us, even as we do this. Because Paul says this. He says, this is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. He explains here, this is why you should do this. He says, for if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, he says, you're eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. And he says plainly, this is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have died. Because we do not understand communion. Because we do not understand the power of the Lord at work at us, even in this moment. It is a holy moment. The problem is because the Word of God teaches us that we should do this often, that sometimes that familiarity can breed contempt. Contempt for something so wonderful that the Lord has done, because we know it, because we know it so well. But Paul, the apostle, inspired by the Holy Spirit, he says, this is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died, because we receive communion in error, because we don't value, we don't by faith receive it. That this is signifying that the Lord did this for us. He died for my sin. He died for me. And I remember and I receive it and I accept it. And I know he's coming back. I know there's life. There's a future. It's not just right now. It's not just about what happens today and for this month and for this year and for my life. It's about the future. It's about the plans and purposes of the kingdom of God and what the Lord is doing. And I'm so grateful that he chose me and we're a part of the kingdom of God and God's plans for eternal life. But then he says this, but if we would examine ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this way. If we would just examine our hearts before the Lord, if we would just say, Lord, if there's anything in me that's not pleasing to you, Lord, I repent of it now, and I give it to you, and I ask you to forgive me of my sin. Lord, I just give it to you. I lay it before you, and I repent. I don't want there to be anything between me and you, and I don't want there to be anything between me and my brother or sister. Lord, I just lay it all before you, and I receive your cleansing blood, and I receive your forgiveness and your righteousness in the name of Jesus. And as the Word of God then says, yet when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned along with the world. See, right now, The Bible says judgment begins in the house of the Lord. We judge ourselves. That's why the Bible says that no one can judge us, because we have this sincere place before the living God when we receive communion and we acknowledge God's presence with us, the power of the Holy Spirit living in us. His presence is with us. It's not this. It's not the wafer. It's not the grape juice. It's the power of the Lord's presence with us, the Holy Spirit living in us. It's God with us. It's two or three gathered together, the Lord saying, "There I am in their midst." And so it's a witness to him. So we receive this bread representing the body of Jesus Christ. Would you take the bread and would you break it and thank him for what he's done, that he died for me, he died for you. And in the same manner, take the cup that ratified, his blood ratified the new covenant. His blood instituted the new covenant that we are all now a part of for eternity, for eternal life, that says we are part of the family of God. We're not outsiders. We're not slaves. We're sons and daughters. We're family. Would you receive the cup and thank him for what he's done? We do this in remembering what you've done, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Would you say amen? Would you bless the Lord? Amen. Sister Linda, could I have you come on up? You know, it's so good. We're in God's presence, faith stirring, but it's also good to hear testimonies. It's good to hear not only that we be encouraged by faith, but also to be encouraged to hear about prayers being answered. So Sister Linda has a great testimony I wanted to share with us this morning.
Good morning, everybody. You know, we all have prayers. I've been praying for my son because he's been really stressed out because he hasn't had a job. And I've been praying. I've been telling him to pray. You know, I've had my church people pray, and my prayers got answered. His prayers got answered. But you know, sometimes prayers don't come really fast. Sometimes it takes weeks. Sometimes it takes months. Sometimes it takes years. But you know, we serve an awesome God, and he brings them to be truth to us. He shows us how real he is. He tells us not to get leery, you know, because it will happen in our time. It might not happen right now. It might not happen when we want, but you know what? It happens. You know, even my other son goes, "Praise God, Mom." He goes, "Look." He goes, "God's such a miracle." I said, "Yeah, he is." I thought he was talking about himself, because I thought something good happened to him, because I'm praying for him too. But no, he was talking about his brother. You know, my boys weren't really raised with God too much, even though I was. But you know what? They've learned to know who he is. They've learned to pray to him when things are wrong or bad or something's coming against them. So keep praying for your kids. Pray to God for your family, for your stresses in life. You know, we all have them, whether it's, like I said before, your family, money, health. He's there. He hears us. So hang on. Pray. It will come, but it comes in his time, not ours. You know, but he does answer them. I've waited for things for years before, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it happens. So I thank him. I thank him every day, even just for getting up in the morning, you know, because we're not promised tomorrow, you know. So I thank you. Thank him. Know he's real. Know he hears you. Know that he's behind you and that he has you in his arms. And he never lets go. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Would you turn to somebody and tell them you're glad they're in God's house this morning? Amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, good morning again. Glad to see you all. Hi, Janet. Good morning. Good morning. God bless you. Glad to see you all in the house of God this morning. Lord is good. Yeah, amen. It is. It's good. It is good. It's good that we get that too, more and more in our hearts. You know, as the family of God and growing and seeing each other more and more that way, it's important for us. A couple of announcements. Of course, we have tomorrow night, Monday night, Foundations class at 6 p.m. You know, we just encourage you, if you want to grow in the Word of God, we encourage you, come on out Monday nights. As I've said before, I'm not trying to scare people off, but just so people know what to expect, it's a deep dive. You know, it really is, but there's so much good in it. You know, it is like you are, best way I can describe it is like you are biting into a big, thick, juicy steak. And sometimes a big, thick, juicy steak takes a lot of chewing. You know, it's good, it's tender and all those things, but you know, you can't just take a bite and swallow it. You need to really chew on it and get it in your heart. And so it's a great class on the foundations of Christian doctrine. Those are good things for us to have in our hearts. It's good for the people of God to be able to rightly divide the word of truth, so that way you can give an answer for your faith, you know, and to be confident in what you believe through the word of God. These are things that we need to have as the people of God. We got to be confident in what we believe. You know, there really shouldn't be areas in our lives as Christians where we say, you know, if a thought comes like, well, you know, I really don't know what the Bible says on that. Well, you should encourage your heart. Go find out. Go discover, you know, and ask, yes, but also, you know, discover and search on your own as well. And the Spirit of God's going to help you and reveal these things. But this class does a lot of that as well. So we invite you to come on out. Prayer this Tuesday night at 6 p.m. It's always good that the church prays. It's important for us to be a people of prayer. So come on out for that. If you're available, Thursdays, 10 a.m., Thursday Bible study. And then, of course, we'll be here Sunday. Yesterday, we had a memorial for Fran Strickland. And so I wanted to just pass along a message from Fran's family. They wanted to say thank you all as a church, because one thing that Fran spoke openly about was her love for this church, for you all, and she told her family about that, and their family knew it. And so I want to pass along their thanks to you as the people of God for loving their sister. And she, of course, loved all of us. She would tell you. She didn't hide it. She told you how beautiful you looked or how handsome you looked, and she told you that she loved you, and she was just a great encourager, and that was from the Spirit of God. You know, because not everybody does that, and she was so good about that. And so, and we will see her again. We will in eternal life, you know. But I wanted to make sure that you knew that, and I thank you for having that heart to love her and to care for her that way. And that's what the church is supposed to be as the family of God. So thank you very much, church. God bless you all. Speaking of thanks, how do we give in the house of God? Giving is something important, not only to keep the lights on and keep things going, of course, but also, you know, the Bible says that we should give lovingly and thankfully. You know, we might not think that. Some people might think, it's an issue, and people get uncomfortable and all those things. The Bible says this, 2 Corinthians 8:24, says, therefore show to them and before the churches the proof of your love and of our boasting on your behalf. And he was talking about their generosity and their giving. You know, that we should know what the Word of God tells us, that we should give lovingly, we should give thankfully. It's been said that a legal giver, somebody who feels that they have to legally give, like, oh, I can't miss, I got to always give. But it's not from their heart, it's because they feel like if I don't give, something bad's going to happen to me. That's a legal giver, that's somebody who's legalistic. Does the Bible ever say to us that God's going to cause something bad to happen because you don't give? But we get this mindset. Now, if we don't give, obviously, that we won't have any finances in the church, and you know, we'll have to shut the doors, of course. But that's not what I'm talking about here. But it's a heart understanding when it comes to giving. You know, many churches, not just us here, I believe we're a generous church. God uses generous people to show his faithfulness, and you are a faithful church, and I thank each and every one of you for your faithfulness, and God bless you all. But many times when it comes to giving, and a lot of times, you know what, for the person that's asking, whether it be a pastor or elder, leader, whatever, it's not an easy thing to ask for people to give. And some people will respond out of a, you know, a certain heart, and some people are harsh and, oh, you better give, and blah, blah, blah. You know, no, that's not what we're doing here. That's not family either. But sometimes it can be, you know, people get locked up when it comes to finances. And we don't want to spend a lot of time on that, but just understand, it's been said that a legal giver gives because he feels he must or she must. Yet a loving giver gives because they love to. They want to. That sometimes takes us to have to really think about that. When you want to do something, there's going to be love in it. You know, when you love people in your life, you want to do things for them. It's the same way. You know, we may not always see that, loving the church that way, loving God's people that way. And you know, and sometimes it comes down, you know, you loving me that way. Not that I'm making this about me, but I'm also a part of what comes in the church. The Bible says those who preach the gospel should live by the gospel. Again, I'm not making it about me here in this moment, right? We're good. I think God's provided is faithful, but it's just a heart of understanding. You know, loving the church sometimes is you love me and Susan. And it's that generosity. It's not because it's going to just a building. It's what's going on in the house of God. So we should not give out of impure motives, just as we should not give out of compulsion or obligation or only a hope of gain either. I give because I'm going to get back. That's the only motive. I give because I'm only going to get back, right? Because even that's not love. That's not how a relationship is. If you're a husband, do you only do things for your wife because you're expecting to get something out of her? That's not love. There might be relationships like that, but that's not love. That's one-sided. Amen?
Yes.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are generous and you provide, Lord. And Lord, we're just having an honest conversation here of knowing that we're in the living room with you and your presence and how much you love us. And Lord, you even put wealth in our hands to give. You even do that, Lord God. That even for the one that feels like, I don't have enough, Lord, I thank you that that's how good you are, that you even put it in our hands to give, and that you bring the blessing and you bring the increase even after that, Lord God, because you're so good. You're a good father. You love your people. And your generosity, we can't ever outgive you, but you're so generous. You bring blessing after blessing after blessing. So, Lord, we thank you and we trust you in all these things. And church, if you agree, would you say amen? Amen. How do we give? We give through the Church Center app, or you can, if you're making a check, make it out to Life Church of Orange, and you can deposit it there in the giving box. And the Lord is indeed good. Amen?
Amen.
All the time, God is good. All right, let's continue on here. Let's get part two. I think we got enough time to finish this message today. We're continuing on from last week. God bless Sharon Simons and the children as they go and learn of the Word of God and bear much fruit for the living God. Amen. Luke 23, let's read it again. Just a review from last Sunday. It says, now it was about the sixth hour. The sixth hour until the ninth hour. So that means it's 9 a.m. I'm sorry, it's 12. I keep messing that up. It's 12 p.m. It's noon. The sixth hour is noon. The ninth hour would be 3 p.m. Okay, so just shy. Right now it's 11, 20, 25, somewhere around there. So somewhere about this time is the Bible is describing when Jesus died on the cross. Just to get that in your knower, just to get that in your thought process, right? Your understanding here. It's about the sixth hour. There was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour, until 3 p.m. And then the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. That's significant. Why was it significant that the sky was dark? Was it because God was so mad that the sun was dying on the cross? What was the purpose here? Well, let's look and let's see. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. So what is he saying? He says, Father, now I'm going to go be with you in paradise. I'm committing into your hands my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. And so when the centurion saw what had happened, he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man. And the whole crowd who came together to that sight, seeing what had been done, beat their breasts and returned. What does that mean? All of a sudden, they now felt bad. Now that condemnation was on. Like, what did we do? What did we do? You ever seen people do that? They just make such a mistake. What did I do? What did I do? What have I done? That's what's happening there. Because if you recall, just prior to that, they're chanting, crucify him, crucify him. If he's really the Son of God, let him take himself down. Ah, rah, rah, rah. Cussing him out, right? Using horrible language to the Lord. Now they feel bad. But all his acquaintances and the women who followed him from Galilee stood at a distance watching these things. That's the disciples and all the women that were with him, those who followed Jesus as followers. And it says here, now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member. So he's part of the religious leaders, part of the Sanhedrin. He's part of the Supreme Council. It says he's a good and a just man. He's not like the rest of them. He's a good and just man. As far as we know from the Bible, it's just Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea are the two believing members of the priesthood or of the Supreme Council of the Sanhedrin who are followers of Christ. They're secret. They're secretive in the way they follow the Lord, but because of the positions that they hold. And we know that God ordained that because what we're going to see right here, Joseph fulfills prophecy. And he says, he was from Arimathea, city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. And this man went to Pilate and he asked for the body of Jesus. And then he took it down. So he takes down Jesus' body. This now it's just a lifeless tent because his spirit is now in paradise with God. Amen. Right? Because last week we saw he told the thief on the cross, today you will be with me in paradise. Right? Isn't that what the Bible says? Isn't that what Jesus said? And he says, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. So what we know, where is he at right now? He's in paradise. He's with the Father. And he brings the criminal with him. Oh, we're thinking about that, aren't we? And so he takes this body. He took it down, wrapped it in linen, reverently, carefully, and he laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock where no one had ever laid before. That's what a rich man's grave looked like. A rich man's grave is hewn out of the stone. You know how much work that takes to cut out? A lot. That's a rich man's game, right? That's the wealthy. Wealthy are going to have a tomb like that. It was prophesied that he would be buried with the rich. He would be on the cross with criminals, but he'd be buried with the rich. And we see how God used Joseph to fulfill that. Amen. Do you see that? So it says here, and it was a hewn out of the rock where no one had ever lain before because it was Joseph's. He had made it for himself originally. That was his plan. But now he realizes this is the plan of God, and he's going to put Jesus in there. And now that day was the preparation. What does that mean, church? That day was Friday. It was Friday. You know, sometimes people get tripped up on they want 24 hours, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, because Jesus said 3 days. 3 days he would be in the grave, and he would rise again. But understand, many times the day isn't always a perfect 24 hours, especially in Hebrew calendar. The day ends at sundown. Sometimes the sun goes down at different times. Amen? So it's not about, but it was always referred. Whenever the sun went down, that was the end of the day. Saturday begins when the sun goes down in Hebrew culture. In our culture, Saturday would begin at midnight. And there's some who try to disprove the message or the story of the resurrection by saying he said he was going to be 3 days. It wasn't really three 24-hour days. It wasn't really 72 hours. No, we understand here, it's the preparation day. The Bible tells us this day, that day was the preparation. So that was Friday. 3 p.m., he dies. He's dead. Joseph goes and talks to Pilate, works it all out. He takes his body and he has it put in the grave. And the whole while, Israel, what's Israel doing? Israel is preparing the Passover, the preparation, the lamb. When God is already having the Lamb of God prepared, being buried, because it has to happen at sundown. Are you following me? Yes. You see the plans and purposes of God even in this, how this all came about? Christ, even though he's dead now, he's still fulfilling all of the law. He's still fulfilling all of the prophets. His body's dead, his spirit. He's already committed his hands into the Spirit of God, church. He couldn't do anything about that. He didn't say, okay, Joseph, make sure you put my body in your grave, brother. No, that's not what happened. Joseph made that grave for him. And we're seeing that the Spirit of God spoke to him in that moment. And he goes to Pontius Pilate. And he says, can I take the body down? I have this tomb already made out. I'm going to put him in there. I believe it's the Spirit of God saying, Joseph, you put him in there. Yeah. Fulfilling. Yeah. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This is something small in the sense of what we're reading here, but understand the magnitude of it. Everything that was spoken of in the Old Testament about the Messiah was fulfilled. Everything about the suffering of the Messiah was fulfilled. So that means we can also trust the things that are spoken of in Daniel that will come to pass as well about the future, as well as in the New Testament. Let me go on. So that day was the preparation, Friday, and it says, and the Sabbath, what's the Sabbath? Saturday. Amen. If you didn't know, the Sabbath is Saturday. Sábado. If you know what Spanish means, right? What's Saturday in Spanish? Sábado. Where did they get that from? It's got it from the Latin for the Sabbath, Saturday. And domingo. That's Latin. The Lord, the Lord's Day. Sunday is the Lord's Day. See, prior to that, they called it the first day of the week. Prior to Christ being risen, it was just considered the first day of the week. Saturday was the last day because that's what Genesis records. When God made the heavens and the earth, he starts on Sunday and he finishes on Friday, and Saturday he rests. So that's the Jewish tradition. That's Hebrew culture tradition. They keep the same thing. Saturday is the Sabbath. Even in Israel today, if you are if you keep the law, you don't do any work on Saturday. That's why the elevators work by themselves. If you have to go in a building, you go into the elevator and it just goes to every floor and you just ride it out, because they keep literally that you do no work. So understand what's happening here. So Friday, Sabbath drew near. They had to get ready because everything has to be done for the Passover before by sunset. It has to be done by sunset. This was the law. It's got to be done by sunset. Jesus is buried by sunset. Because God is saying the Lamb of God has now been sacrificed for all of mankind who believe, for everyone who believes. Okay? So now and the woman who had come with him, the women rather, who had come with him from Galilee, followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. They were watching everything. They loved the Lord. They loved the Lord. That wasn't because they were nosy. They loved the Lord, and they wanted to watch everything. They wanted to make sure that their love for the Lord, that he was treated good even when they buried him. Because they loved him. And they're saying, we want to make sure that our Lord was taken care of. He's being buried. We want to make sure he's buried right. Their whole world has been blown away, church. They weren't expecting him to die, even though he told them. And they're not, we read on, we're going to read next week. Where are they going on Sunday morning? They're going to bring the spices because surely his body has been dead for 3 days. So you know the carcass is starting to smell. And they want to make sure that it doesn't smell. And that's why Mary Magdalene is coming, bringing spices. Because she thinks he's still dead. She's not expecting him to rise from the dead. So the Sabbath drawing near, the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb, how his body was laid. And then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, because they're going to bring them on Sunday. And then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Because, see, you can't even prepare the spices on the Sabbath. You can't do any work. That would be work. So they have to prepare. And you also have to understand, church, there is, we're Christians. We're new covenant, but there is a Jewishness that we should observe and appreciate in our Christianity. That's why everything in the Old Testament, they kept the law, and so we should have reverence and respect for that. Not to, it's dumb, why do you guys do that? We'll only follow what the New Testament says. No, you should absolutely value everything that's in the Old Testament and apply it to your heart for wisdom and understanding, because there's so many truths about Christ in the Old Testament. We're going to see that. After we're done here, and we're going to do some studying on who God is in our lives and some things for vision for the church after we're done here in Luke. But then after that, we're going to go through Genesis. We're going to go through the beginnings of all things and study and understand. And for some of us, it's going to be, why do we do that? Why do people do these things? We're going to see a lot of that in Genesis. But we're also going to see Christ in Genesis, yes, the plan of God in Genesis. So we're going to spend a lot of time in the Old Testament as we go into our next study. But I'm just telling you that to understand. We shouldn't disdain it, but we should appreciate it and value it and understand these things. Amen? Yes. All right. So they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. Amen. You know, 1 Corinthians 15:26 tells us this. It says that the last enemy that will be destroyed is death. Death is our enemy. This is what the Bible tells us, and it's going to be the last enemy to be destroyed. Christ conquered sin and the power of death, hell, and the grave by his victory on the cross. So I want to consider some important aspects that the Gospel of Luke records for us about the crucifixion. So there was darkness over the whole earth, and the veil in the temple was torn in two. What's the significance of the darkness? Well, first of all, we do know that Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? This is happening. But also understand this darkness is occurring because Christ is the Passover lamb. He's being sacrificed just as the darkness comes. Because that's when the Passover had to be done. It had to be done at sundown. Christ, our Passover lamb, is fulfilling the Old Testament. Did he do it in his own strength? No. He's under control of the Romans. They're the ones that are executing him. They're the ones that are putting him on the cross. So the sun is darkened at noontime. It's Passover, and according to the law, the sacrifice had to be made at sundown. Christ, our Passover lamb, sacrificed at sundown, even though it occurred from noon to 3 p.m. because of the supernatural darkness and the sun being obscured. What also is happening, Colossians 2, 14 through 15, we did briefly talk about this last week. This is just a reminder, but, you know, you might have a thought, why did they have to, you know, why didn't they slit his throat? Why didn't they drive a dagger through his heart to kill him? Why did he have to be nailed on the cross? And Colossians 2, 14 through 15 answers it for us. It says, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. See, the devil and the demonic realm thought that when Christ is going to the cross and he's being nailed, they thought it was their victory. But actually, the Bible says it was our victory. Amen. Christ, when he's being nailed, God is using it. And he was taking away this certificate of debt that we owed because of our sin. And he's nailing it to the cross, saying it's paid for. That God was doing this. That God was seeing to it that as he's nailed to the cross, that God being nailed to the cross, the Lamb of God on the cross, what's happening is all of our sin, the debt that we all owed that we could never repay, is being paid for by him on the cross. And this is what Colossians 2:14 is telling us. He has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. And then it says this interesting passage here, having disarmed principalities and powers. As he was being nailed, the principalities and powers were losing all their power. He was disarming them, and he was making a public spectacle for all eternity of them. See, he endured the shame on the cross, but once this happens, all of a sudden now the tables have been turned. Yes, and now all the demonic realm realize they've been duped. They realize that they played into the very hand of God and what the purposes and plans of God was to bring salvation for all who would believe. Praise God. And that's good. That's something to praise God about. You know, but it says this, according to the Apostle Paul in Colossians 2, Christ on the cross, in his flesh, he cancels the certificate of debt owed. But then also what's happening here is Satan and all the demonic principalities and powers were being stripped of their stolen power. They didn't even realize what was happening. They didn't realize that they were being publicly shamed by Christ's victory over them. They thought they had all the power, and then they realized that they're powerless. They thought that they had stolen authority because of what Satan did in the garden with Adam and Eve, and they think that this is just the culmination of their victory. They're realizing that as those nails are going through Christ, all of a sudden they're losing all their power.
Hallelujah.
They're losing all their authority. Praise God. Satan was completely shamed and fooled as the sacrifice that he should have stopped it. If he would have known, he would have gotten in the way of it, and he would have never let Jesus die. I mean, think about that for a moment. That's really what was happening there. If he really understood, he didn't know the plan of God. He didn't understand it all. He's not God that he knows the wisdom of God, right? He's a fallen angel. He can observe. He can watch. That's what they're called. The Bible refers to these angels. They're watchers. They're just watchers. They're just watching. The devil's been around for a long time, so he's able to watch you. The demonic realm is around for a long time. They know what you like. They know what your falls and your stumbles are. And so they're going to get at you for the things that you have failed in. But the power of God helps us and gives us strength to overcome. But the devil doesn't know. So guess what? He's tempting Judas, thinking that this is going to, he's like this. Right, he's thinking it's going to fall into his plan. Oh, this is great, and now I'm going to enter into Judas. Man, we're just going to get Jesus. Pride comes before the fall. Amen, Sister Pam. And the continual pride that, and he's completely duped by it. He's aiding, basically. He's aiding by his involvement with Judas into the plan of salvation for mankind. God's plan, God's will. Nothing's going to stop God's will, church. Even when it looks like the darkest day, even when it looks like it's the darkest day, God always has the last word. Always has the last word. We always look to God. God, the victory is in Christ Jesus. The victory was the cross. And the confirmation of that victory is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so this is why we see the veil is torn in two. devil fell right into it. Now the people of God have full access to God all the time. We don't have to go to this temple. You know, if this hadn't happened, church, if you wanted to seek God, you'd still have to go to the temple in Jerusalem. And you'd still have, and then right now, let's just put this in real world terms. There is no temple in Jerusalem. It was destroyed. AD 70. But because the work of God had already been fulfilled, the veil is torn from the top down, signifying God was making access for mankind. Torn from the top down, now you have full access to come to God. That didn't exist, church, before Christ. You didn't have that kind of access. And part of the promise in Christ is the Holy Spirit. You're not born again unless you're born again by the Holy Spirit. Yeah. And then through the baptism of the Holy Spirit is the power of God comes. So we understand what we have in God because of what Christ did. The devil didn't understand all of these things that were going to come about. He thinks he's making his way and causing as much damage as he can and messing things up. And he played right into the hand of God. He's a fool because of his pride. Understand this, church. What was behind the veil was the holiest place. Even the high priest could only enter once a year, the Day of Atonement, as Pam was sharing earlier in pre-service prayer. And he had to come with a bull's blood as sin offering, as well as of a ram as a burnt offering, according to Leviticus 16:3. The veil had to be torn in order for us to have access to God. Jesus had to die in order for mankind to have access to God through the acceptable sacrifice of the Lamb of God, resulting in the forgiveness of sin for all who believe. His blood is the once and for all ultimate offering for sin. And this is important because it signifies for you and me, for us as believers, that we have complete and full access to God. We have complete and full access to the Holy of Holies. This is why when you pray, when you are in that serious place of when you pray, God is hearing you. Amen. He's hearing you. He's hearing you. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So when you pray, he's hearing you. I've said this before, but think about it. If you have somebody that, let's say monetarily, let's say money-wise, is very wealthy. Like, just wealthy, wealthy. Like, money is not even an issue. Like, Shohei Ohtani money. That was for you, Johnny. Just where you could go and say, hey, what if we, let's go do this. And they're like, sure, not a problem. Let's go rent out a stadium and go have a party. Okay, let's go do that. Right, just a large amount of money. It's almost incomprehensible. You kind of go, wow, okay, that's a lot. Now, consider in real terms the access that you have to God, to the Lord. You're a child of God. And he tells you that when you pray according to his will, he hears you. See, part of the issue is we have to learn what the will of God is. This is why James warns us. The book of James warns us and says, you have not because you ask not. Or when you ask amiss to spend it upon yourself with selfish motives. But when we pray according to God's will, and God's will includes needs. Yes. God's will includes healing. Yes. God's will includes interceding for others. Yes. And their situations and what they're going through. The Bible says God's going to answer that. Amen. 1 John 5, 14 and 15 says, if whatever we ask, we know that he hears us. We have the petitions that we've asked for. God answers. And I think sometimes we need to hear that in our spirit. That God answers. God answers our prayers. That's why I had to have Sister Linda come on up, because sometimes it takes time. Sometimes it does. But that's not for us to grow weary in believing. That's just for us to say, okay, Lord, I trust you in this. I know that you have not forgotten me. I know you're bringing the answer. And we believe you. We believe you, Lord God, that you answer. So we understand this, that when we pray, 2 Corinthians 5, 19-21 says, that is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. You know that God, many times when you're talking to somebody about the gospel, that's the Holy Spirit pleading through you. So you don't have to have all the answers, but just rely upon the Holy Spirit. He's going to tell you what to say. He's going to tell you what to say. It's going to come out your version, but he's going to tell you what to say. He's going to give you wisdom that you may not have been thinking about. All of a sudden, words are just going to start coming to your heart and mind, and you're going to start saying them. And it's wisdom. It's wisdom from heaven. It's wisdom from the Word of God as we've kept it and stored in our hearts. And so it says this, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now the torn veil also signifies that now, because of Christ's atonement for us, we have the Holy of Holies living inside of us. You have, as a believer, as a child of God, you have the Holy Spirit, who is the Holy of Holies. There is no holy place, church, other than the Holy Spirit. There is no holier place other than him living inside of you. That's why the Bible says we are now the temple of the Holy Spirit. And sometimes we need to guard ourselves in that. Don't expose yourself to things that you shouldn't be exposing yourself to, because you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. Don't take the Holy Spirit where he shouldn't be going. In other words, don't take your body to places where you wouldn't want the Holy Spirit to be going, because he's in you. And not just physically, but in your mind. Amen. And in your soul. Don't go to those places. Don't go to that place of anger and unforgiveness with the Holy Spirit inside of you. Because what's going to happen is he's going to become real quiet inside of you. And in that unforgiveness, you're going to be asking God, why can't I hear you? Why can't I hear you? Because you have unforgiveness in your heart. God loves you. That's not going to change his love for you. But he's calling us to repent. He's calling us to be like Jesus. Jesus doesn't hold unforgiveness towards us. Why should we not be forgiving of others? And who are we to think that it's okay and acceptable to take the Holy Spirit in that place of unforgiveness? See, what we do is we quench the Spirit of God. And that's why sometimes we come to the church and we think, oh, it feels so good and this is so good, we're in God's presence. But when I go home and I'm doing my thing during the week, I don't feel that. Well, it might be because unforgiveness, you're letting unforgiveness live inside you and you're not willing to repent. Amen. Luke 23:46, it says, and when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last. What he cried out was what John records in the Gospel of John when he said, it is finished. John 19:28-30, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. And now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And that's what Luke was recording, that he cried this out with a loud voice, it's finished, it's done. And then he bows his head and he gave up his spirit. He bowed his head and he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And he was dead. While the Gospel of Luke focuses on what Christ accomplished on the cross, we know that there are other miracles that occurred at this moment. There was an earthquake and it opened the graves of the saints. Many bodies of the saints arose. Look at this, Matthew 27:51-53, it says something very interesting about this moment, the power of God that was revealed. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split. And get this, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Okay, you see that? They're raised. And then look at verse 53. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Wow. Jesus dies Friday. Graves are opened. But the saints don't come out and start walking around till after the resurrection, is what Matthew 27 says. It's after the resurrection. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us what happened to these saints, nor does it tell us who they are. It doesn't tell us if they were great, well-known, or just saints of God. And it doesn't, we believe that they obviously fell back asleep again at one point because they're not around anymore today. But just see the power of God, what's happening in this moment. The miraculous power of God at work. When Jesus died and he said, it's finished, that was it. All of the satanic dominion lost all its power. And death in this moment was now being transferred from its own power back to God, back to Christ. And so you're seeing the result of that is these saints who believe, they're waiting on God, and they come up out of the grave. And they start walking around after Christ is resurrected. Could you imagine what's going on in the town? What's happening? And other Christians and believers, like, what is going on here? What is happening? See, the graves were opened at his death when the earth quaked, but the saints don't immediately come out until after the resurrection. It's only the saints of God that are raised and resurrected. It's not just people, they're saints. The Bible specifically states that. This is a picture of our future resurrection as well, church. They most likely died again, but when the second resurrection occurs, we will live forever in a resurrected body just like Jesus. Why is this important? Why is it important for you to know? I believe it's more than just a miracle. I believe it's intended to help us see the fulfillment of what is to be. You know, out of the New Living Translation, Philippians 3:10 says, I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death, so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection from the dead. What's Paul the Apostle talking about? He's talking about dying to self in this life. He's stating how I need to die to myself. To my flesh. My flesh wants to do whatever I want, but that's not Christ. That's not Christ living in me. He says, I want to suffer with him. In other words, when you deny yourself, there's a suffering. When you say, don't do what your flesh wants to do, you're denying yourself. There's a suffering in that. You know, sometimes you might go, why is it so hard? Because there's a suffering in that. Look what the Word of God says. Why is it so hard to stop doing this? Because there's a suffering in it, brother. That's the work of God in you. That's the Holy Spirit saying, no, don't do that. I have something better for you. Don't do that. Trust me. Trust me that I have something better. Don't do that. Rely on me. Come to me. I'm the one that can satisfy your soul. I'm the one that can fill your hungry heart with goodness. It's me. It's not that thing or that idea. See, if the story stops at the death of Jesus Christ, we really miss the point. He had to die in order for us to have real life, eternal life. Jesus prays this before he dies on Thursday night. He says in John 17:3, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, that we may know God, the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. This is eternal life. This is what eternal life is all about, is knowing God. This is what it's all about. This is what it's going to be like forever, is being one with God, being one with the Father, being one with Jesus, knowing God the Father, knowing Jesus Christ, being in family with the Lord. And we know him now through his Spirit. We have eternal life now, church, by faith. Jesus further helps us to see that knowing God and Jesus Christ, that's eternal life. That's the way to eternal life. And that's what we're always going to have. We know it now by the Spirit, but one day we're always going to have that. One day that there's going to be a physical aspect of it as well that we're going to know. So what does this mean for us today? What are we to do with all of this? Yes, it's the victory and power over sin for us, but I believe it also points to what our future is to be like in God. His death, Christ's death, is hope for you and me. What he suffered on the cross, what the prophet Isaiah prophesied in chapter 53 details for us, what Christ suffered on the cross. You know, I don't have the scripture up there, but just think about it. What did he do? He suffered, it says, surely he's borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. What is he talking about? Depression and grief. Christ carried all that. So we don't have to be depressed. We don't have to give in. We don't have to be obligated to depression. We don't have to be obligated to grief. We esteemed him stricken by God, smitten by God, but he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. He paid the price for our sin. We don't have to feel guilty over the past anymore, but we can be free of it. And it says the chastisement, he was beaten up, he was chastised for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. What he suffered on the cross, church, was for our peace and for our healing. So it's not just when we die and go to heaven, but the hope of a resurrection is what we need to see. Not just the salvation of our spirit, but a new resurrected body. What Christ did on the cross was for our future. Amen. Look at here, 1 Corinthians 15, 42 through 49. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. What does that mean? See, when you die, yes, it's sown. Incorruption. This tent is done. This tent's getting older. I was saying the other day, it's like, you know, I saw a picture of us, a baptism. We had a baptism Sunday. And we're in the baptistry. And Susan showed it to me. My beard was all black. It was Josiah? Oh, we're baptizing Josiah. Awesome. And Brother Ed looked the same. My beard was all black. And I looked at the picture, and I was like, oh, wow, that was like just yesterday. And I'm like, no, it's not. Look at me. But this tent, right, it's corrupting. That's okay. Because there's something more. It's not just about this. That doesn't mean that I should not take care of myself and, you know, right, live healthy and all those things. You know, no, that's not. This body doesn't belong to me. It belongs to God. And then as a married man, it also belongs to my wife. Good. What? That's not in the Bible. Ooh, some men are going to be mad at me today. But also realize, wives, your bodies belong to your husbands. That doesn't mean you take advantage of her. You're her protector. You're her defender. You're her most secure place. Let me go on. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. That doesn't mean a ghost. Come on. It's saying now it's a spirit-empowered, spirit-fueled body. Hear what I'm saying. He who has an ear, let him hear. Amen. Amen. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. Now understand, Jesus was not a ghost. He's not a ghost. We'll see that next week. He's not a ghost. He is a living body. What's one of the first things he does when he comes to the disciples? Right? He's like, rejoice. Y'all got anything to eat? That's real right there. That's real. Been in the grave 3 days. It's the end of the day. Y'all got anything to eat? Touch my hands. And he specifically calls out Thomas, because Thomas was the one that had, unless I touch his hands and, you know, put my hands inside. And by that time, he's like, no, 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 Lord, no, no. Forgive me. Right? What was I thinking? So he's not a ghost. Understand, church, we're not going to be ghosts either. There's a demonic realm. We can't see them. Those are the false things. But they're under our power as Christians. Amen. So let me go on. The first man was of the earth, made of dust. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are made of dust. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man. One day, church, you and I are going to bear the image of the heavenly man, of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us we don't know what it's going to be like, but one day when we see him, we will be just like him at the second resurrection. See, we get this picture of, okay, I die and I go to heaven, and I'm going to be in heaven forever, and it's going to be wonderful, and that's why we get these weird ideas of naked babies on the clouds playing a harp, and that's not our future.
Come on.
Yes, I am. We are. If the Lord does not come back before I die in this life, I'm going to go right into paradise, and I'm going to enter into the mansions of God, and Jesus has prepared a place for me, just as he prepared a place for you. But that's not my eternal home. That's not what the Bible says, church. That's not my eternal home. My eternal home is with Jesus. My eternal home is with him. He is the house of the Lord. The Bible tells us that one day the house of the Lord is going to come from heaven, from God's throne, to the new earth. That the old earth, this earth, is going to be done away with, and these heavens, these planets, these galaxies, even though they're beautiful and wonderful, they also are going to be done away with, and there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And Revelation 21 tells us that God says, behold, I make all things new. And that's going to be for us. And one day, the new Jerusalem, the heavenly Jerusalem, is going to come down in the new earth, and God's presence will be there. And that will be the new house of the Lord. And that's what King David says in the 23rd Psalm, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We will be with him on the new earth. But guess what also is going to happen prior to that? Revelation 17 tells us, and I'm kind of skipping ahead here for time because we're already way over time, and I'm not going to make this a part three. The Bible tells us that Jesus is going to return with his church, and he's going to defeat the Antichrist. He's going to defeat the false prophet, and there's going to be a 1,000-year reign. Satan will be cast into his pit for 1,000 years, but Christ is going to rule on the earth with his church, and he's going to rule with a rod of iron. This earth with a rod of iron. And I believe that explains what Psalm 2 says. If you're interested, go read what Psalm 2 says. Why do the nations so furiously rage together against the Lord and his anointed? And the Lord sits and he laughs at them. Because there's nothing that the kings of the earth are going to be able to do, because the Lord is going to rule and reign on the earth with his church. And there's going to be 1,000 years, a millennium. Praise God. And that's just the beginning. It's going to get better after that. There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth when Satan is destroyed and Gog and Magog are destroyed, and they'll be cast into the lake of fire, all those who hate God. And then there'll be the new heavens and the new earth, and that's when the Bible says there'll be no more tears. There'll be no more sorrow. God's going to wipe away every tear. And I believe at that point, that's when we're going to be living the lives that really God intended for us. All the creative abilities, all the things that you have in your heart, and the desires and the strengths that are in you, you're going to see them fulfilled in that life, which is our future. But you're not going to get sick anymore. Hallelujah. You're not going to get sad anymore. There's no longer going to be all the things that we deal with. There's no more anxiety, no more fear, no more all that, because God's with us. His glory is with us, and we're like him. Amen? There's a great future that we have because of Jesus when he's died on the cross and what that means. It's not a sad story. That's why we call that Friday Good Friday, because it was good for us. Yeah. It means life. It's not just this life, church. Yeah, this life, this body does get corrupted, and there you go. What are you going to do about it? there's a better body coming. There's a better resurrection that's coming for us. Amen? Let me read this to you, closing, just to get this in your heart. Alexis, you can come on up if you want. Revelation 21, 1 through 5. Again, heaven isn't our final destination. Eternal life is the final destination. It says, "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea." That means there's going to be plenty of room for everybody. You know, you look at the map, you look at the earth, the globe, there's parts of the earth where all you see is sea. You know, you go look at Hawaii and then you go over to Asia. There's a big blue sea out there. There's a lot of water on this planet. Well, the new earth is not going to have a sea because there's going to be a lot of people inhabiting the earth. There's going to be a lot, I'm going to call them kingdoms, on the earth. And God's going to be putting you within those kingdoms as a child of God, as a representative of Him and His goodness. But we'll all be with Him together. Maybe you'll travel instantaneously. I don't know how God's going to do it, but we know that He does it. Also, then I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, meaning it's going to be beautiful. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people. God Himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." And then He who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And He said to me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." Ultimately, it points to what God intended from the very beginning. He intends to be with us. That's what God's intention. He intends to be with you. Why does He want relationship now with you? Because He intends to be with you. Why did He send Jesus? Why was Jesus called Emmanuel, God with us? Because He intended to be with us. Why in the Old Testament was it all about, you know, the temple? Because God's presence was there. That was God meeting with His people. He wanted to dwell with His people. Why did Moses have the tabernacle to meet with His people? Why did Jacob make set up Bethel? It was God's house because that's where God could meet with Jacob. God wants to meet with us, church. And ultimately, because He wants to be with us forever. And He wants us to be with Him. He wants us to know Him. And I think that's why it's important that we understand when Jesus died on the cross, what it really meant is it meant we now have a relationship with God, why the veil is torn from the top down, why all those things happen the way they did, is to know that we have relationship with Him, His power working in us, the life of God, that He's able to change us. He's able to transform us, making us more and more into the image of Christ. It's not about, "Lord, why is it so hard?" It's about understanding, no, there's some good things coming in the power of God. God is able to transform our hearts. If we will seek Him, we will find Him when we search for Him with all our heart. Can you say amen to that today, church? Let's close our Bibles. Let us pray. And Father, thank You for Your word. Thank You, God, that You bring enlightenment to us from Your scriptures, from Your word, and You bring life by the Holy Spirit. And I pray the life of God upon each one here. Lord, that they would see You in a greater way and understand how much You have purpose for Your relationship with each one. Lord, Your blessing, Your goodness over them, and let them be strengthened in You continually, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Love you all. We will see you this week. God bless you.